All right. Well, I think we can go ahead and get going. So it is my pleasure to introduce Michaela Walterová. Michaela has been at the Faculty of Mathematics and Physics at Charles University in Prague since 2010. But just in the past year, she has earned her PhD working with Dr. Marie Benikova. And she is now a postdoctoral fellow working remotely at DLR in Berlin. So, Michaela, thank you so much, and I'll just give it off to you.
Thank you, Joe, for the introduction and for inviting me to this seminar. And good morning, everyone. My name is Michaela Walterová, and here I'm going to speak about the thermal and orbital evolution of terrestrial exoplanets with a special focus on the role of tidal interaction. The talk is mainly based on my PhD thesis, which was elaborated at the Charles University in Prague under the supervision of Maria Běhounková. So first, let me clarify, how does the tidal interaction contribute to the thermal and orbital evolution? The tidal interaction also presents a link between these two different aspects of planetary evolution. Tidal loading, tidal interaction between two bodies, two celestial bodies orbiting close to each other, results in the evolution of their spin rates, rotation rates, in the evolution of the obligatory, and in the evolution of the orbital elements, such as is the orbital eccentricity and the semi major axis. A well-known example of the tidal evolution of spin rate is the synchronous rotation of our moon or of other large satellites in the solar system. Tidal loading of bodies that are neither perfectly elastic nor perfectly fluid also results in the dissipation of mechanical energy and in tidal heating. And tidal heating then alters the thermal budget of the bodies and can also contribute to their internal evolution. In particular, the evolution of interior temperature affected by the tidal heating affects the temperature-dependent parameters of the planet and its interior structure. It can also lead to partial melting and to increased volcanic activity, such as is the case with the Jupiter's moon Io. The tidal loading depends on the orbital parameters as well as on the interior structure of the planet. So these two domains are inherently linked. The orbital evolution affects the rate of thermal evolution, and the changes in the interior structure of the planet affect the rate of orbital evolution. And by the end of this talk, we will focus exactly on this interconnection. So first, a few introductory slides about the tidal interaction. Tidal loading is basically a consequence of a differential force acting on an extended body. In our case, the extended body is a terrestrial planet. Here's a picture of planet Mercury. And the planet is under the action of some perturber, which is here the host star. In a reference frame, co-orbiting with the planet is subjected to gravitational force, which is stronger in the substellar point than in the center of the planet or in the antipodal point, and to centrifugal force, which is whose magnitude is constant everywhere inside the rigid body. The resultant force then stretches the planet. Here, the resultant force points toward the star, here away from the star. And as the planet stretches, it assumes the shape of a prolate spheroid. Realistic planets do not deform instantaneously, but the deformation is gradual. And if the planet rotates under the perturber, under the host star, then the tidal bulges that form may get carried away from the line connecting the centers of the two bodies. Then the symmetry axis of the prolate spheroid does not coincide with this connecting line. and the perturber exerts additional force on the tidal bulges, and it gives rise to tidal torque. The tidal torque then affects the spin rate of the planet. And, it leads to the evolution of the planet's spin rate. And it also follows from the conservation of total angular momentum in the system that as the planet spin rate evolves, also the orbital elements evolve. To formalize the tidal theory a little, we may introduce the tidal potential, which then the tidal force is expressed as the gradient of this tidal potential. And the tidal potential can be expanded into series in spherical harmonics in the space and in a Fourier series in time. Each mode of this decomposition then corresponds to a different tidal frequency, and the individual tidal frequencies are given as a linear combination of the mean motion, the mean orbital frequency, and the rotational frequency. The individual modes depend also on the mass of the perturber and on all the Keplerian elements of the orbit, the semi-major axis, the eccentricity, and the inclination of the perturber's orbit with respect to the planet's equator, and also on the argument of pericenter, the longitude of the ascending node, and the mean anomaly. Similarly to the tidal potential, we can also expand the additional potential due to the deformation of the planet. And particularly in linear tidal theories, each mode of the additional potential is related only to the corresponding mode of the tidal potential. The modes of the additional potential then depend also on the radius of the planet and on the planet's interior, which is parameterized by this parameter, the Love number, and by the tidal lag. The tidal lag basically tells us what is the angle between the symmetry axis of the deformed planet, of the prolate spheroid, and of the line connecting the two bodies. The additional potential present of the tidally deformed planet presents a perturbation to the two-body problem. So we can insert this additional potential as a source of orbital evolution to the Lagrange planetary equations, which describe the evolution of Keplerian elements. Now we may inspect the functional form of the evolution equations. Here the evolution equation for the semi-major axis and of the tidal torque. Then we will see on which variables does the tidal evolution depend. The rate of tidal evolution depends strongly on the semi-major axis. So the tidal effects will be most prominent for planets orbiting very close to their host star. The tidal loading also depends rather strongly on the planet's radius, but this doesn't necessarily mean that giant gaseous planets are evolve tidally faster than terrestrial planets, because the rates of tidal evolution are also given by the planet's rheology and interior structure, which is parameterized by these two quantities. And the tidal phase lag of terrestrial planets can be, or usually is, larger than the tidal phase lag of gaseous planets. Now we will focus on the parameterization of the planet's interior. The deformation of the planet depends on the interior structure and the rheological properties of the body. And it can tell us how much does a planet, well, the knowledge of the interior structure can tell us how much does a planet deform under the action of tides, and how long does it take for the tidal bulge to form. In the case of a perfectly elastic planet, the tidal bulge forms instantaneously. And the planet's deformation is then determined by its rigidity. The deformation at the planet surface can be parameterized by two Schiedel numbers, which describe the deformation of which describe the radial and the tangential component of the tidal deformation. Here, g is the surface gravity, and phi is some mode of the tidal potential. In addition to these two numbers describing the deformation of the planet, there is also this potential of number, which we have already seen. And it tells us what is the ratio of the additional potential to the tidal potential on the surface of the planet. In the following, we will only focus on this potential of number, which is which is required by the evolution equations. So this was the elastic case, but realistic planets are not perfectly elastic. They deform gradually. In the case of linear viscoelasticity or linear anelasticity, we can describe the deformation of the planet by a set of governing equations, which are in the frequency domain equivalent to the governing equations for the elastic case. This can be done thanks to the principle of correspondence between elastic and linear viscoelastic continuum. In the non-elastic case, the Schiedel numbers become complex and they are frequency dependent. And their frequency dependence is given by the interior structure and by the adapted rheological model. Here, here we would have the complex of number, where the magnitude of the complex of number tells us what is the magnitude of deformation, and the phase of the complex of number tells us what is the phase lag, what is the lag between the tidal force and the additional force. If the planet can be described as a homogeneous sphere, then we can prescribe the complex of number analytically. It depends on the mean density of the planet, the surface gravity, and the radius of the planet, and also on the complex rigidity, which is given by the rheological model used. Yeah, if the planet is not a homogeneous sphere, but rather a radially stratified body, the complex of numbers cannot be calculated or cannot be expressed simply analytically in this way, but they can be calculated from the normal mode theory. In this approach, the spheroidal deformations, attractions, and additional potential in each layer of the planet can be expressed analytically and parameterized by six complex parameters, C, which are constrained by the boundary conditions in the center of the planet, on the internal interfaces, and on the surface. The complex of number in the layered case is then given as a combination of the parameters on the surface of the sphere. So this, similarly to the homogeneous case, also in the case where the planet is described as a radially stratified body, the complex of numbers depend on the densities, radii, and complex rigidities of the individual layers. And the complex rigidity depends on the rheological model. So here, in the next slides, we will focus on the rheological model that can be used for the description of such planets. The rheology, or the response of materials to some external loading, for platforming materials such as our silicates, ices, or metals, depends on the frequency. On long timescales, corresponding, for example, to mantle convection, the behavior of such materials is described by viscous creep. On short timescales, on the other hand, and the timescales relevant to seismic waves, but also to tidal loading, the deformation is described by elasticity or anelasticity. And we can study the anelasticity of materials by observing the attenuation of seismic waves or of mechanical waves in the continuum. The attenuation of seismic, also tidal waves, in these planet-forming materials or in the Earth mantle depend very weakly on the loading frequency. In the range of frequency, this is true in the range of frequencies relevant to seismic, to seismology or to tidal loading. Here, this parameter is the internal friction, which characterizes the amount of mechanical energy which is dissipated during one cycle of the external loading. And in case of Earth-sized planets, it is approximately equal to the sign of tidal phase lag. The internal friction is proportional to the loading frequency to some negative exponent, and the value of this exponent is typically between 0.1 to 0.5. This behavior of the Earth mantle and of the planet-forming materials, which is verified by geodetic and seismological observations as well as laboratory experiments, can be described by the Andrei trilogy. The Andrei trilogical model accounts for the elastic instantaneous deformation, for the linear viscous creep, and also for the transient creep, for the anelastic response of a planet to external loading. The viscous creep is most important in cases of low mantle viscosity or low loading frequency. So now we have introduced the Andrei trilogy and again go back to the tidal effects, in particular to the tidal torque within the Andrei model. The tidal torque acting on the tidally deformed planet depends on the loading frequency, but also on depends on the mean motion, but also on the eccentricity of the orbit, on the obliquity of the planet, and also on the spin orbit ratio, on the rotation rate of the planet. On these four plots, the x-axis shows the spin orbit ratio, the ratio between the rotational rate and the mean motion. And on the y-axis, there is the tidal torque acting on a model planet, which is in this case an Earth mass planet orbiting a low mass star. On the upper left plot, which corresponds to zero orbital eccentricity and zero planet obliquity or axial tilt, we may see that the tidal torque has this specific shape within the Andrei model, and it goes exactly once through zero. Each zero crossing of the average tidal torque means that the planet here assumes a stationary rotation state, that its rotation doesn't evolve anymore. So for planets with zero obliquity on a circular orbit, the stationary rotation corresponds to the spin orbit ratio equal to one or to synchronous rotation. In the rest of this talk, we will be interested in non-zero orbital eccentricities. And with non-zero eccentricity, which is the case on this second panel, there are multiple zero crossings. So there are multiple stationary rotation states corresponding to spin orbital resonances. Spin orbital resonances are these ratios of the spin rate to the mean motion, which are equal to some small integer or half integer value. In the case of non-zero obligatory, the picture gets even more complex, but in the rest of the talk, we will set the planetary obligatory to zero. So we will not study these cases. A planet with some initially high spin rate is subjected to negative tidal torque. So it spins, and it spins until it gets locked into some stationary spin state. I should also say that the stability of spin orbital resonances depends also on the orbital elements and on the parameters of the rheological model, the end rate model in this case. So with very low mantle viscosities or at low loading frequencies, there would be only one stable spin state on all of these panels. And this stable spin state would not generically correspond to any spin orbital resonance. In the case of low mantle viscosity, the only stable spin state is a pseudo-synchronous non-resonant rotation. Well, here we have seen the tidal torque in the end rate model, and we can also look on the evolution of the orbital elements and of the spin rate on long timescales. So here in this illustrative case, the timescale is extremely long. It is 60 billion of years. And here the model planet is initially on an extremely eccentric orbit. The initial orbital eccentricity is 0.2. And since we are only studying the evolution of the planet under the action of tides, there is no other eccentricity forcing. And the star in this model is considered as a point mass. The orbital evolution is relatively simple. The orbit undergoes gradual circularization. That means that the semi-major axis shrinks gradually and the eccentricity decays. The spin orbit ratio first, the spins to its first stable spin state, to the highest stable spin state corresponding to these orbital elements. And then it gets locked into some high spin orbit resonance. And the resonance can be only destabilized by decreasing the orbital eccentricity. The spin orbit ratio then follows this staircase dependence on the time, as it always transitions to lower and lower spin orbital resonances together with the decrease in eccentricity. And finally, when the eccentricity is low enough, it despins to synchronous rotation, which is the only stable spin state of planets at low orbital eccentricities. So here we have only studied the evolution of the orbit, but now in the next step we may look at the evolution or on the parameter dependencies of the tidal dissipation, the tidal heating, which then contributes to the thermal evolution of the planet and then also affects the orbital evolution. The tidal heating will be calculated using this formula. And it again depends on the same parameters as we have already seen in the case of tidal torque and of the orbit, the evolution equations for the orbital elements. On the following slides, we will see several parametric studies where we will show the surface tidal heat flux, which is this average tidal heating divided by the surface of the planet. The model planet in these cases will be an Earth-sized body consisting of three layers, a liquid core with the same size as the Earth core, then a viscoelastic mantle described by the Andreid rheological model, and an elastic lithosphere. The thickness of the elastic lithosphere in this case will be 50 kilometers and will be constant in the parametric studies. The planet will orbit along, on a relatively close in orbit around Aloma's star. So on the first parametric study, we'll set the rigidity of the planet's mantle to a constant value. And we will study the effect of the mantle viscosity and of the orbital eccentricity on the high stable spin state and on the average surface tidal heat flux. On the first plot, we may see that there are two domains with different characteristics of the stable spin state. At very low mantle viscosities, as I've already indicated, the planet can only get locked into one spin orbit resonance, which is named the pseudosynchronous rotation, and it doesn't correspond to any spin orbit resonance in general. It only depends on the orbital eccentricity. At high mantle viscosities, on the other hand, we may see multiple stable spin orbit resonances, which depend on the orbital eccentricity. The higher the viscosity and the higher the eccentricity, the higher are also the spin orbit resonances that get stable. And here the boundaries between the regions of different high stable spin orbit resonances are also indicated in the second plot, which shows the surface tidal heat flux. An interesting feature of this plot is that for higher than synchronous spin orbit resonances, the surface tidal heat flux is almost independent on the orbital eccentricity, and it depends mainly on the mantle viscosity. So if we choose some initial eccentricity, as on one of the previous slides, and we evolve the eccentricity to lower values, the tidal heating would remain unaffected for a long time, and then it would only drop once the planet despins into lower spin orbit resonance. On the next two slides, we will choose constant eccentricity and look at the parameter dependence of these quantities of the spin rate and of the surface tidal heat flux on the mantle viscosity and the mantle rigidity. So here on the first slide, the orbital eccentricity is set to a constant value of 0.05. So the eccentricity is rather low, and here are only three stable spin orbit resonances in this parametric space. The the higher than synchronous spin orbit resonances are only stable at high orbital or at high mantle viscosities. And in the second plot showing the mean surface tidal heat flux, we may see that there is always some region of maximum tidal heating. And if we choose some initial mantle viscosity and we decrease it, or we are interested how the tidal heating is affected by the decreasing mantle viscosity, we would see that the mantle viscosity first increases, and then once the planet despins from this higher spin orbit resonance, 3-2, to the synchronous rotation, the tidal heating drops by the order of magnitude, and then it can increase again. On the next slide, we only change the orbital eccentricity. So now it will be higher, 0.2. And here there are now multiple, or there are more than three stable spin orbit resonances. And for example, the 3-2-2 spin orbit resonance is stable even at low mantle viscosities for some range of mantle rigidities. In the tidal heating plot, the pattern is relatively similar to the previous case, but here the drop in tidal heating when we transition from one spin orbit resonance to another is not so prominent as in the case of small orbital eccentricity. So in these parametric studies, the mantle viscosity and the mantle rigidity were treated as free parameters. We only looked at dependence of these quantities when we change these parameters. But now what if these parameters depend on the temperature, which can be affected by the tidal heating? So here this slide or this plot just shows the dependence of mantle viscosity on the mantle temperature at some constant pressure. And the viscosity also depends on the melt friction in the planet. The melt friction is again given by the temperature compared to the local solidus temperature in the material. And with increasing melt friction, which is this dashed line, the mantle viscosity can drop considerably. So how would the planet, would the planet evolve under the evolution of not only the the orbital elements, but also the interior? I'm sorry. So if we choose some high initial orbital eccentricity and mantle viscosity, then the planet is subjected to extreme tidal heating, and it also gets locked into high spin orbit resonance. Extremely tidally heated planet evolves very quickly. Its eccentricity decays quickly, and it also shifts to lower mantle viscosities. As the eccentricity decreases, the planet also despins to lower spin orbit resonances, the tidal heating decreases as well, and the evolution rate of the planet again decreases, and the viscosity increases. So then the planet slowly evolves to low orbital eccentricity, and the tidal heating gradually diminishes. We are using a parameterized 1D convection model where the energy balance in the mantle and in the core is described by these two simple equations. The evolution of the temperature in the mantle is given by the heat flux from the mantle to the lithosphere, by the heat flux from the core to the mantle, and by the volumetric tidal heating. Here in this equation, there is also Stefan number, which parameterizes the melting in the planet. And similarly, for the equation governing the temperature evolution of the planet's core, the thermal fluxes in this parameterized model are related to the average mantle viscosity, which it depends on the temperature. And the temperature is affected by tidal heating. The dependence of the mantle viscosity on the temperature is described by the Arrhenius law, and it can be further affected by partial melting of the interior of the planet. Here, the parameter at zero is the reference viscosity at some reference temperature, 1600 kelvins. This epsilon is the activation energy, and R is the universal gas constant. So now we may look at the fully coupled model of tidal induced thermal orbit evolution, which is here. These plots were calculated for a model inspired by the exoplanet Proxima Centauri B. And in the upper row, we may see the evolution of the orbital elements, such as the eccentricity and the symmetry axis, and the evolution of the spin orbit ratio. And on the lower row, there is the evolution of the thermal state of the planet, of the surface tidal heat flux, the temperature at the top of the convecting mantle, and the average mantle viscosity. Different colors of these lines correspond to different reference viscosity at this reference temperature. And the dashed lines correspond to the orbital and thermal evolution of a planet with a constant mantle viscosity, which doesn't depend on the temperature. So if we choose one constant, or if we choose one reference viscosity, for example, 10 to 21, we may see that since the eccentricity of the model planet is initially rather high, it's 0.2, the planet despins to higher spin orbit resonance, 2 to 1. And the high spin orbit resonance and high eccentricity results in increased tidal heat flux. And this also leads to a steep increase in the interior temperature and steep decrease in the average mantle viscosity. Since the tidal heat flux in this case is relatively high, the eccentricity decays quickly. And the planet despins into lower spin orbit resonance, which corresponds to the lower orbital eccentricity. The temperature in this case drops or evolves to some lower value. And then it is constant as long as the planet maintains this high spin orbit resonance. After the planet finally despins to synchronous rotation, which is here, the tidal heating starts to decrease gradually, and also the mantle temperature decreases gradually, the planet cools down. So the long-term coupled thermal orbit evolution of tidally loaded planets is characterized by a series of thermal equilibria, which are governed by these transitions between spin orbit resonances, which depend on the evolution of the eccentricity and of the viscosity. You may also see that thanks to this final spinning to synchronous rotation, the orbital evolution gets very slow. And the planet's orbit may maintain long-term non-zero eccentricity. So to summarize the talk, we have seen that in the NDRA trilogy, the planet's spin rate usually evolves to some resonant state, to some spin orbit resonance, which depends on the mantle viscosity and rigidity, on the loading frequency, and also on the orbital eccentricity. And the dependence of the stable spin orbit resonances, which also partly determines the tidal heating on the model parameters, is very complex. The tidal heating at higher than a synchronous spin orbit resonances is almost independent on orbital eccentricity. And the coupled thermal orbital evolution proceeds as a sequence of thermal equilibria, which are governed by the transitions between spin orbit resonances. The transitions also change the slope of the orbital evolution, and this can lead to the maintenance of long-term non-zero eccentricity of the orbit. So that's all I wanted to say. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Michaela. That was a great talk. So if anyone has any questions for her, please feel free to raise your hand or you can put them in chat. I have a few questions, but I guess I'll start off with one. What is the transition? I saw in the earlier plots, and you mentioned it, that when you're in the spin orbit resonances, the tidal dissipation tends to only be a function of viscosity. It has a very weak function of rigidity. Exactly. So like that figure there. But then when you go, I think about two slides ahead, it doesn't seem to have that anymore. I was just wondering if you could talk about that transition.
Yes, here on this first slide, the y-axis was the eccentricity. So the tidal heating is almost independent on the eccentricity, but it depends on the rigidity.
Okay, so I gotcha. I was reading the plots wrong. All right, does anyone else have any questions for Michaela?
I see a question here in the chat.
Oh, so yes.
Yes, I have one. This is
Go ahead, Raja.
Yeah, can you pull up your slides on your 1D convection? Oh, yes, this one. If I understand correctly, the heat flux from the core to the mantle is completely due to the cyclic cooling of the core, right?
Yes, you're right.
Is any sort of tidal heating of the core fluids or any other radiogenic material in the core could affect your conclusions? This is my question.
Yes, so any other sources of heating in the core would affect the energy balance in the planet and the long-term evolution. But in this case, the tidal heating in the liquid core is relatively low, and I'm not sure whether it is possible to have some radiogenic materials in the iron core. But if we are studying the evolution of icy moons where the core would be silicate, then yes, that it would be necessary to also include the effect of the radiogenic elements in the silicate core or of the tidal heating of that core.
Thank you.
Okay. Does anyone else have any questions? While we're waiting, I'll ask another. I was wondering, your partial melt model affected the viscosity. Did it have any effect on the rigidity, the shear rigidity?
Yes.
Okay.
I only illustrated the effect on the mantle viscosity, but the rigidity in our model is constant for a large range of the temperatures, but then there is a similar transition from the higher constant value to some lower constant value when the material begins to melt. So the minimum mantle rigidity in our case is 10 to minus 7 pascals in the case of fully molten medium.
Gotcha, very cool. And then my last question I had was, and we spoke a little bit of this offline, but the transition between the one-to-one spin orbit resonance and the pseudosynchronous, the PSR, at low viscosities, I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit more about that. Like, do you see a specific trend where there's, you know, a set function of viscosity where PSR starts to become important, or does it really depend on the situation?
I've seen it only in these parametric studies. Mm-hmm. That, and it is quite interesting that the one-to-one resonance is only stable very close to this boundary with the 3-to-2 resonance. So there should be another boundary between the one-to-one resonance and the pseudo-synchronous rotation. Mm. And also the pseudo-synchronous rotation close to the one-to-one resonance is a little different than far away from the boundary. But, well, here, this is only the a question of the color scale of the color boundary.
Right, so you're saying that the one-to-one is only like right up against the 3-to-2 on that mm-hmm. on that type of plot? That's really interesting. It'd be interesting to explore that more, mm-hmm. see what's going on there. Great. Does anyone else have any other questions? All right, well, I'm not seeing any. So Michaela, thank you again so much for talking with us today and dealing with the time zone difference. It was really great talk, and it's great to hear from you.
Thank you very much for inviting me.
Of course.